Okay, we ready?
Just about.
Let's go.
Right, so this is episode 14 of the Bon Jovi Talk podcast. Today, I've got the drummer of the Blaze of Glory album, played on Destination Anywhere, played on Undiscovered Soul, as we know, the Richie solo album. I've got Kenny Aronoff today on the podcast. I can't believe that I've got a man as a guest so early on into the podcast, but there we go. I'm absolutely delighted to have him on. As we know, he's a fantastic drummer, played in one of the best albums, not just from Bon Jovi or Jon, but of all time with Young Guns 2. So Kenny, I'll let you introduce yourself.
Well, I'm Kenny Aronoff, and I'm right now in Raleigh, North Carolina on Experience Hendrix tour with the virtuoso guitar player Joe Satriani and Doug Pink on bass and vocals, who's one of the founding members of King's X. And we are on this incredible tour. Started on March 3rd and ends on April 6th. And it's just a huge, large amount of musicians all playing Hendrix songs. And as a matter of fact, when we were in Nashville the other night, Phil X and John Shanks and Tico Torres came to watch us play. So that's where I'm calling from, Raleigh, North Carolina. We have a night off tonight.
So how did the Jimi Hendrix experience come about? How did you get involved in that?
Well, I was on tour with John Fogerty and ZZ Top this summer, and I got a call from Joe Satriani's manager. And wanted to know if I was available to go on tour in March and then also in October. And I said, man, I would love to. And they said, could you commit to it? And I went, absolutely. Because I played with Joe Satriani in a super group called Chickenfoot when Chad Smith, who's one of the founding members of Chickenfoot. And for those who don't know what Chickenfoot is, it's Sammy Hagar and Michael Anthony from Van Halen, and then it's Joe Satriani and it was Chad Smith from the Chili Peppers.
Oh. So
Chad had to go on tour with the Chili Peppers, so he recommended me. We actually did play London when we did it. I think it was 2012. But so that's how I remained friends with Joe, and he picked me to be in his trio, and we're our own entity. You know, I have my own drums. Everybody's got their own instruments, because a lot of people sit in on the show and they use the same basic, they use the same drummer for all the other performances, which is Chris Layton from Steve Ray Vaughan's band. He's a great drummer. And then they'll use the original bass player in the Jimi Hendrix Experience, not Noel Redding. Well, actually, what? Noel Redding was the original Hendrix bass player. Might have been from, he was obviously from England. I can't remember if he was from Liverpool. But anyway, the point is, I'm spacing on his name. He's Billy Cox, who's like 80 years old, sings like amazing, walks amazing, plays amazing, acts like he's 50. And he's the other bass player with Chris Layton, and he trades off with another bass player. It's pretty cool.
Well, I was actually looking at, some of the recording artists that you've worked with, and you've got such a good list of names on there. Obviously, not just Bon Jovi, take Bon Jovi aside, some of the names that you've got on there, I was looking, you've got obviously people from years back, and then you've got people who are current now, like Brandon Flowers was one that stuck out for me, because I quite like The Killers, and I like Brandon's solo stuff, and some of the names that you've got on your list, on your resume, are absolutely fantastic.
Yeah, it's pretty, I've just worked real hard, but the things that are unique is that, usually when you become famous as a drummer, which is very difficult to do anyway, usually you get pigeonholed as a live drummer or a studio drummer. And I managed to be very successful at both. Then the other thing is you get pigeonholed as, oh, he's a rock drummer.
Yeah.
Oh, he's a country drummer. Or he's a fusion drummer. Or he's an R&B drummer. And I broke all those rules. I broke every single mold. I mean, to give you a short example, I mean, I recorded and performed with Johnny Cash, Willie Nelson, Kris Kristofferson, Waylon Jennings, George Jones, Loretta Lynn, really traditional hardcore country artists. But then I, came to Wales and recorded with Tony Iommi and Glenn Hughes and Mammoth. And then I toured the world with the Smashing Pumpkins and recorded with Alice Cooper. And those are harder bands. But then I also played with Buddy Guy, Ray Charles, and B.B. King. Recorded with them. But then I did the female artists like, Melissa Etheridge, Celine Dion, Michelle Branch, Avril Lavigne, Alanis Morissette, and then the more traditional artists, which is, like the Elton John, the Sting, Santana, Rod Stewart, Joe Cocker, Bob Seger, Bob Dylan, Iggy Pop. Hell, I even performed recently with Lady Gaga and Bruno Mars at the Kennedy Center Honors. Springsteen, I mean, it just goes on and on and on,
That is one thing that I noticed, as I said, when I was looking at the list, I was thinking it's not just a fantastic resume, but it's really diverse. So as you said there, you've got people like Jon Bon Jovi and Elton John, Bob Dylan, and then on the flip side, you've got Ricky Martin and Avril Lavigne. And yeah. I was looking, I was thinking, wow, that's a really different type of mix of people that you've got.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, it's true. The thing that I'm fortunate that, the producer, these producers, I'm the go-to guy because when I play, and I was telling Dave Grohl this because when I did the Kennedy Center Honors, the first year I did it, I had to play with seven artists doing, we were honoring the Who in one part of this show. Let me explain. The Kennedy Center Honors is a very, very, it's a very intense, high level show. It's like, it would be like playing in the World Cup or in our country, the Super Bowl or the World Series, or, it's the President of the United States is there. It's in an elegant hall. It'd be like playing for the Queen at Royal Albert Hall.
Yeah.
That's what it's like. And so, there's a lot of pressure. They got 16 cameras, they're filming, they're recording, and you have to be able to read music. But anyway, my point is, when I played the Who segment, with Dave Grohl and Chris Cornell and other people, five other artists, I played like Keith Moon. I wrote every single note that he played on those songs, and I tried to emulate Keith Moon as if I was an actor in a movie, and I just got into the role of crazy Keith Moon, playing on top of the beat, reckless abandonment, kind of almost like a drum solo going through the music. But what I pointed out to Dave is the next segment that I had to rehearse for was I was in the George Jones segment, which is honoring one of the most traditional country artists ever. And I was telling Dave, like, check this out. When I play the hi-hat, I'm going to play very, very, very light. Because in country music, the hi-hat's just kind of like a little metronome, keeping time. And the bass drum, instead of slamming the beater into the head, I come off the head, and all I'm trying to do is support the tones on the bass guitar. And the snare drum, I don't hit very hard. Usually I hit the rim of my snare drum and the center of the drum. But with the country music, that traditional country music, I hit the center of the snare drum and played it lighter. And I played either in the middle of the beat or I played behind the beat, laid back. And when I was telling Dave that, he was like, wow, because he only plays like Dave Grohl, which is great. He doesn't have to play like anybody else. He's doing fine with the Foo Fighters.
Yeah.
But when you're a session drummer like me, my role is to be extremely authentic at the style of music that I am playing. I have to play like as traditional as I can that will serve that kind of music. And that, I got a reputation for that.
That, as I said, like, you know, you've got, obviously, you want to play out, you know, the way you want to play. And obviously, with the bunch of names that you've got, the list of names, obviously, it's going to be, people are obviously going to have their mind, their way of having you play on their albums as well and on their singles. And one thing when I was looking at the list was, with that list of names, is there anyone in particular that you wish you would have played for or play, you know, played live with or you know, released just a song with?
Well, anybody that's on that list I already played with. You know, the list that is on my website, I already played with those people. But are you asking other people
yes.
that aren't on my
yeah, list? Yeah, sorry. So if there was anyone who's not on the list.
Oh, man. There's so many people I'd love to play with. I'd love to play with Queens of the Stone Age. You know, anything with Josh Homme would be cool. I like everything, you know. I mean, there's so many people. You know, the lead singer, guitar player, piano player from Muse just popped into my head. I mean, that guy is so gifted as a songwriter, singer, guitar player, piano player. Probably plays drums better than me, you know. That guy, I would love to tour with Sting. I played live with him, but I would love to tour with him. You know, and I'd like to have Jeff Beck as my guitar player.
Did you ever?
So cool. Yeah, I've never played live with Jeff, but I might be. I mean, he was on Blaze of Glory, but yeah. He didn't record at the same time.
Yeah,
he came in a different time. But geez, I mean, I like so many. I like anything that's authentic. Anything that's authentic. I'd love to do it. Be like the White Stripes with Ed Sheeran. He sings, plays guitar. I play drums. No bass. You know, anything. If it's authentic, and I'm playing with great musicians, it's all good. It's always good. You know.
Did you never do anything with David Bowie?
I never did. No, I never got the opportunity to record or play live with him.
Yeah,
never.
Me dad.
Cool.
Yeah, my dad's a massive Bowie fan. And when I was saying that I've got you on the podcast, he was wondering whether you'd been on anything with Bowie before.
No, I mean, when I was in the Johnny Cougar Mellencamp band, we really looked up toward David, and John really took a lot of ideas from him. As a matter of fact, when we were doing American Fool, which won two Grammys, John brought in, spacing his name, I haven't said his name all. You know, David's main guitar player forever, the blonde haired guy from England. Dang, what's his name? Spacing it out. Nick, no, Ronson, Mick Ronson.
Yeah.
When Mick came in, is it Mick or Nick?
Yeah, Mick Ronson.
Mick came in, and he was the one. The biggest hit single that John Mellencamp ever had, I don't know if you know, it's called Jack and Diane. It's got a big drum break in the middle of it, which really put me on the map. And we were struggling with that song. And I ended up programming a drum machine because that was the newest thing. You know, a drum machine. It was a Lin-1 drum machine. I programmed it. I mean, I was really frustrated because I was being replaced by a machine. You know, it's 1981. I'm like, are you fucking kidding me? I'm gonna be replaced by a machine. I'd already been replaced by two drummers the two years before, and then all of a sudden they wanted that this big drum solo, and I had to create a drum solo, but that would be suitable on pop radio. And you know, it was huge. It was this big break. Kind of like what Phil Collins did on In the Air Tonight.
Yeah.
But then it was Mick Ronson that said, well, he was there. He said, "Look, keep have Kenny keep playing the drums, and you do a drum groove, a beat, and sing the chorus on top of it. Everybody be singing it, you know." Oh yeah, life goes on. I don't seem to do it anyway. it was really cool, and it was a mixed idea. So that's as close as I got to Bowie.
Yeah, he was a fantastic guitarist, Mick Ronson. Like, I must admit, really good guitarist.
Yeah, he was exceptional at coming up with cool parts, and he looked cool. And he wasn't like the guitar player, like takes these like screaming fast solos. He was a melodic guitar player. He came up with parts and ideas.
Did you ever listen to his solo album?
No.
It was pretty good. Really good. Really good album. Obviously, I only got into it through my dad, but I enjoyed it. It was a good album from what I heard of it.
Yeah.
So obviously, as I said at the start, we all know that you played on the legendary album, Young Guns 2. So obviously, I've got to speak about that. So,
sure.
How did that come about? How did, you know? Obviously, John was in the band for 6 or 7 years before he decided to go solo for a short time. So, how did he approach it on playing drums for that album?
Well, I got a call one day from John. He just called up, said, "Hey, Kenny, it's Jon Bon Jovi." I'm like, "Wow, cool." He says, "Listen, I'm writing a couple songs for this movie soundtrack called Young Guns. He said, would you be in the recording?" And then I said, "Yeah, of course." And he says, "Well, I'll call you in a couple of weeks. I'll tell you what the, try to figure out what the schedule is." Calls me a couple of weeks. He said, "Well, I got 4 songs I wrote for the movie." I went, "Oh my God, that's even better." And then he goes, "I'll call you in a couple of weeks and tell you what's going on." Calls you up in a couple of weeks and says, "Dude, I just wrote 10 songs for the album, and I'm going to act in it. It's going to be the soundtrack for the movie." I'm like, "Oh man, I'm like totally excited. I'm going to be recording with Jon Bon Jovi." He calls me a couple of weeks later. He says, "I got good news and bad news for you." I said, "Well, what's the good news?" He said, "Well, Jeff Beck is going to play on the album." I went, "Oh my God." I said, "I've always wanted to play with Jeff Beck." I was flipping out. I said, "What's the bad news?" "Oh, well, Jeff wants to use Terry Bozzio, the drummer." And I went, "Oh, okay." And I went, "Well, what can I say? Terry Bozzio is an amazing drummer." So I hung up the phone and I was like really bummed out. I was walking back and forth in my house in Indiana going, "God, this sucks." And then about 5 hours later, I get a call from there's 2 producers, John and a guy called Danny Korchmar.
Yeah.
Danny calls me up and goes, "Hey, Kenny, what's up, man?" This is, not much. He says, "Listen, have your drums there at 9 a.m. on Tuesday." I went, "Danny, have you talked to John lately?" "Yeah." "Well, didn't John tell you I'm not playing on the record?" He said, "Oh, bullshit. You're playing on the record." He said, "No, I'm not." He said that Jeff Beck wants Terry Bozzio. He went, "Fuck that." He goes, "Listen, Jeff Beck," and I should have known this, "Jeff Beck's not going to go in and track guitar all day long with us. We record the song. Jeff Beck comes in, plays a solo 2 or 3 times and leaves. That's the way it's going to work. You're the right guy for the album. Have your drums there at 9 o'clock.
That's amazing. Wow.
Well, that's what happened. And then John and I became very close. We had met each other when Mellencamp was big, and we were on the same label. Bon Jovi was starting to come up. I remember we did like a Farm Aid or something. I'll never forget. We had long hair and like a leather jacket with fringe on it. And he was, wow. I mean, he was, you know, real good looking guy. And he was an up and coming rock star. He looked like a rock star, and he was, you know, always friendly. And then when we did this record, we'd hang out. It'd be like me and him and Jeff Beck would go to the movies, because I wrote an autobiography called Sex, Drums, rock and roll. Mm-hmm. And John was one of the guys I had interviewed in the book, because I wanted to interview people that were significant in my life. And playing on Blaze of Glory was significant. One of the most important records, because it was very successful. And it really, when Mellencamp took a break from touring and making records, I created a whole new business, which was being a session drummer. And that was one of the biggest records I recorded. And then we'd stay in touch. I mean, he invited me to go on a 2-week motorcycle trip across the country. And I didn't do it because I was such a workaholic. I had recording sessions. That's one of my regrets, that I didn't do that. I should have said, to hell with it, not record and have that experience going across the country on Harleys.
Yeah.
But then John started hiring me. Like, I did a Billy Falcon record. I did an Alda Nova. He's an artist from Canada.
Yeah.
All kinds of stuff, you know. And then he, yeah, you know, obviously I did his next solo record. And then we went to the Super Bowl together. We all chipped in some money. We got our own jet and flew down there to New Orleans. And he was like really good friends with the coaches from the New England Patriots, you know, Bill Parcells,
yeah,
and Bill Belichick. And yeah, it was cool, man. We had a great time until we drank too many of those stupid hurricane drinks down there. Oh my God, that's the worst.
Well,
the worst. There's more sugar than booze.
Well, as you said, John obviously phoned you up and said, you know, he's writing a song or two, and then he said he was writing 4, and then he said he was writing 10.
Yeah.
Was the plan for you to be on the original 2 and then the original 4 and then the next 10?
Yeah.
Was that always the plan? Was you always going to be writing, you know, or was you always going to be the drummer for every song?
No, yeah. I mean, yeah. His plan was to have me do the whole album. Absolutely.
Wow. So he obviously liked you then.
yeah, I guess so.
So can you describe what it was like recording that album? Because obviously for us, I mean,
it was great, man. First of all, every song I heard, I knew this is amazing. But
yeah.
Blaze of Glory, I knew it was going to be a big hit.
Yeah.
I could just tell. I just knew it. I just knew it was going to be big. And I remember, I'm the type of person, when I record, I mean, I record as if it's a live show, a live performance, and I'm just going for it. And I was going for it, and I just, you know, sweat was coming down my face. I was just totally sweat, and I always play like it's my last performance, and I really give everything I can to it. And that was cool, man. I just knew that was going to be big. And there was that middle section where it breaks down. I do like a marching drum thing.
Yeah.
For the listeners, what I did was I wrote that part. I came up with that part, and I played it on 4 different snare drums, different sizes. And I even had them speed up the tape, and I would record one of the snare drums. I duplicated. I know I may have had 2 parts. But the point is, when you speed up the tape and you record it, when it's sped up, when you slow it down to the original speed, it lowers the snare drum. So a high snare drum could sound really low. And I stacked these 4 drums together. It was really cool.
Well, looking at the, you know, obviously the track list, there isn't a bad song on it. As you said, you knew it was going to be a hit, and you certainly knew Blaze of Glory was. But the one song that... Yeah. For me and for fans, that really gets us is Santa Fe. I just think vocally, musically, lyrically, everything, it's an absolute, we call it a masterpiece, to be honest. It's one where it really shows off. Obviously John's vocals. And that, can you remember recording every song for that album?
No, I can't remember. I remember Blaze of Glory the most.
Yeah.
Or was it Billy Got Your Gun or something?
Yeah, Billy Got Your Gun. Billy Got Your Gun.
I write everything out. So I write all the drum parts out. So when I'm recording, I can really, I can focus on the performance. And I remember walking in the first day, and John would go, he always calls me Handsome Kenny. I don't know where he got that from. Maybe he calls everybody that, but he'd go, Handsome Kenny Aronoff. And I go, what? I look behind me. I thought he was making fun of me. Because, I mean, you know, John's so good looking. I always thought he was making, I thought he was making fun of me. So I turned around thinking he was talking to somebody else. And it was me. Like, I looked at him like, me? He said, yeah, Handsome Kenny Aronoff. He's still, you know, he just had a birthday and I texted him and, you know, he says the same thing. Hey, Handsome, thank you.
But that's actually, if I remember right, I'm going to have to have a little look at the booklet, but I'm certain it says Handsome. I'll have to have a little look.
It might be.
Something's telling me I remember seeing it years ago. It does as well on Billy Get Your Guns. Handsome. That's the.
It's like, like I said, he is making fun of me or he is being nice and thinks I'm handsome. I don't know.
That's a cool story. The fact that just when you said that, then something clicked in my head and I thought I'm going to have to have a look. I've seen that somewhere.
Yeah.
And you were seeing that somewhere.
Yeah. He's I don't see him that often, but he's one of the nicest guys I've ever met.
Yeah.
Very cool.
So obviously, as we said, we'll carry on with the Blaze of Glory album, but we also recorded on Destination Anyway.
Mm-hmm.
How much input did you have on that album?
Oh, I did some cool stuff. I mean, that was with the producer, super creative guy, or some of the songs were done with Dave.
Stewart.
It was cool, man. We did some cool stuff. But I, on that record, I created some loops where I would play like a small drum kit and I'd play this one beat over and over again. And then they'd loop it and then run it through some sort of, you know, electronic gear. So it'd be super cool. So we started to explore new ideas that we didn't do on Blaze of Glory.
Hmm.
And because that's what I was doing on other records too. You know, I'd learn all kinds of things from different projects and then I'd bring them to the other projects. You know, instead of hitting a snare drum with a stick, I'd hit it with a gourd with beads on it. And then have an African drum next to my hi-hat.
Yeah.
And then instead of hitting a hi-hat, with a stick, I would have I would play a crasher, which is this metal, you know, two pieces of metal on top of each other, and I'd play it with something that looked like a coat hanger. Weird stuff. I'd mix it up, same beats but different, with different sounds. You know,
how long did it take to record both albums? Really, did one take a lot longer than the other? Because they're two very different sounding albums, really, aren't they? The John solo albums.
Well, Blaze of Glory we did in 2 weeks. I mean, that's how long I spent in the studio.
Wow.
2 weeks. I mean, you took the weekend off. So it'd be like, maybe it was 5 days, or maybe it was a song a day.
Wow.
No, I don't know how many. It took 2 weeks.
Yeah.
Destination Anywhere, we did in segments. We do a couple of days of Dave Stewart's studio, and then we take a break. We mixed it up.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So obviously, with you recording both, did you see a difference musically from John? Because as I said, in my opinion, both albums are totally different. You've got Destination Anyway, which is almost quite like a, I want to say a dark album, but it's not too dark. It's got a dark type of vibe to it. Whereas,
yeah,
Blaze of Glory, Young Guns 2 is quite a powerful album, I find. Did you notice the two? And obviously, when you were in the studio recording both albums, did you notice a difference?
Of course, absolutely. I can hear everything.
Yeah,
yeah, absolutely. Two different things. Everybody grows and everyone develops and, you know.
What was it like listening to John record? Because vocally, as I said, Blaze of Glory is pretty much Jon Bon Jovi at his peak. What did you think of his vocals? Yeah. Obviously, once you started there and sing live in front of you.
Oh, it was great.
Yeah.
When you hear a singer like that, it motivates you to play, you know, differently. Well, you know, when I play, that's what I love recording, when a singer sings live in the studio with you. And, you know, it's motivates me to play differently, and then I motivate him to play differently, sing differently. You know, that's some of the reason why maybe people will hire me, because I motivate the session.
Yeah.
I get along with people. It's not just my playing. It's more than that. It's my energy. It's my personality. And I definitely connected with Jon.
Did obviously with recording the both albums, and then did you think that had an impact on you, obviously recording some songs for Richie? How did that come about? Did you think it was Jon kind of said, you know, come and ask this guy to record on your album?
Well, my concern was that one guy wouldn't want to have me play on their record if I was on the other guy's record.
Yeah.
But I did John's first, then I think I did Richie, but it was the producer that hired me to do Richie's, and Don was.
Ah, okay.
And, it wasn't Richie, but Richie approved it.
Mm.
You know, everybody approves, you know, the artist always approves, you know. But yeah, I mean, I think it was a crazy time where I was going back and forth, like maybe within 1 month, back and forth. Well, I might have been doing John's, and then I was doing Richie's, and I was doing the Rolling Stones, mm-hmm. playing percussion on their record. Jon Fogerty during the day. I mean, it was just insane what I was doing. It was jumping from one thing to the next.
With the Young Guns album, we know that Jeff Beck was on it as well, and Elton John, and a couple of other famous musicians. Was there a time when all of them were on that album? All of them were in the studio at the same time?
I never saw Jeff Beck, but Little Richard and Elton John were there, I think, the same time.
Wow. That must have been unbelievable to witness.
Oh, yeah.
What was it Elton John like working? Well, obviously, as I said, I've seen on your list that you've worked with him before as well. But
He was fantastic. And it was great. He asked me to go tour with him. And it was one of the most difficult things I've ever done, was I turned it down because I wasn't ready to leave Jon Mellencamp. And I went on tour. I mean, I turned on Elton John tour to stay with Mellencamp. That was almost one of my regrets, you know.
Did Jon ever ask you to go on tour?
In my life, yeah.
Did Jon Bon Jovi ever ask you to go on tour with any of the albums, obviously Blaze of Glory and Destination Anywhere?
Yeah, he did. He wanted me to go out with Destination Anywhere to promote it. But I was going on tour with Jon Fogerty.
Okay.
And I had already been committed to that.
Yeah.
And that was horrible, having to say no to Jon. Oh, it really sucked.
Mm.
We went out to dinner. It was just me and him hanging out. And, I wasn't ready, because I was a member of the Fogerty band, so we were going out all the time. And touring a lot, and Jon was good wanting to do a promo tour, and I had to make a choice, and so I did. I that was another time I regretted. That was a tough decision.
Suppose if you know, as you said, if you've kind of agreed to doing something already, it's just one of them things, I suppose, isn't it? You can't.
Well, most of the time I try to do that, but things do come up where you have. That was a tough one, man.
Yeah.
You know, I wanted to do both. It was a tough one. You can't win.
Yeah.
You're gonna disappoint somebody and yourself.
Yeah.
And that's just the way it is. I get into that quite a bit.
Well,
you know.
How much influence did working on, you know, the Blaze of Glory album make you want to work on the Destination Anywhere album? Was it just a no-brainer to say, yep, I'll work on your second album?
Oh, yeah. Well, it's never, I always say yes to everything.
Okay.
Unless, I never say no. Unless, the only time I say no is because I'm busy.
Yeah.
I'm already booked. Yeah, that's the only time I say no. I mean, no, that wasn't a problem. Actually, there was a minute there I was, there was another time John asked me to do a possibly tour. But it didn't happen.
Yeah.
And I played with him with in front of Bill Clinton, the President of the United States once at the Ford Theater.
That's just when I was saying about Elton John before, and he featured on Dying Ain't Much of Living, the song on Blaze of Glory. How much input did he have on that song? Did he turn up and change anything that John had already planned, or did he just kind of go with the flow?
Well, the demos were very well worked out, and we pretty much stayed strict to it. But I can't remember if we did any editing, because before we went in, we were very, very prepared. He was very prepared with Danny Kortchmar, Aldenova was involved, I think, and John. So everything had been sorted out pretty well.
Yeah. Again, just kind of going back, I know I keep going back to it, but the Blaze of Glory album, but when you was doing them 2 weeks and you said, you know, yeah, I know this is going to be a good album, did they kind of, to you, did they go bigger than you even imagined? Because as I said, you know, solo albums, obviously the band Bon Jovi were kind of hitting really like a peak at this point with New Jersey and Slippery When Wet, and then for John to go solo, I suppose that was a big risk, but you said you kind of knew straight away it was going to be a big album. So did they overtake your expectations?
Oh no, I thought it was going to be really big. The music was so good, it was so John. I just knew it was going to be big. Plus Bon Jovi had such a huge following.
Yeah.
And usually when the lead singer puts out a record, they're going to draw from the band. But what John realized, though, in my opinion, is he realized Jon Bon Jovi is one thing, but Bon Jovi is bigger. The band is bigger than the individual.
Yeah.
And teams are bigger than individuals. Teams win Super Bowls and World Cups and World Series and NBA playoffs and Stanley Cup hockey tournaments, not individuals, but every individual on the team should strive to be the MVP, strive to be the best they can be on the team they are. So like Bon Jovi, John is an MVP player in the Jon Bon Jovi band, just like Rick and Richie is, and when Tico and all these guys, they're all MVP players, they're the best.
Yeah.
But as a team, they work better than as individuals. Same with Mick Jagger. I played a couple of his records. And he figured it out. Mick Jagger's Mick Jagger, but he knows he's not the fucking Rolling Stones.
Yeah.
It's the whole Rolling Stones. It's the Rolling Stones. That's what these guys are brilliant at.
They
figured that out.
When obviously you got asked to do Destination Anywhere as well, did you notice a change in John's character at all? Had he matured from 6 years before, 7 years before, as a person?
Yeah.
And as a musician, absolutely. I suppose.
Every artist, as they try to progress and keep their career going, they tend to get more and more serious, because now they understand that, you know, their time is only for a short period of time. What Bon Jovi's done, just like a Springsteen or even Elton John, to sustain that kind of following is huge. That's a big deal. Very hard to do that. But eventually, you know, your fans die off. And then they go, eventually you can't keep going up, 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 and up. But I think that John, at that point in his career, was seeing how it gets more and more difficult to come up with, you know, phenomenal hits. And you know, it's tougher and tougher to stay at the top. And John's done an amazing job doing that,
Well, I mean, obviously they're my favorite band, but they're still, you know, they're still getting the number one albums and still getting the number one tours. So, as you said, it's certainly John and obviously the band, as you said, it's a team of have all done extremely well to be in the position they're still in now, let alone 20 years ago. But as I said, you know, with him being, he said that he's seen a change in his character and towards his music. And what a lot of us fans hear from people who've worked with John and but certainly just fans who've met him and other bits, they say that John's a perfectionist. When you're in the studio, do you get that impression as well?
He's heavy perfectionist. Yeah, John is extremely competitive with himself and a perfectionist. Absolutely.
Do you still listen to any of the Bon Jovi music now? Are you aware of what they release or anything anymore?
No, I haven't heard. I'll listen to the records when they come out, but I don't know what. I have any idea what they're doing except what they're recording right now.
Yeah. Well, obviously, yeah, they're in Nashville as well now at the moment, recording their next album. So obviously,
that's where they are right now. Yeah, I think.
Well, the good thing that I'm seeing there with this new album is that they've got, you know, Phil X is in the studio with them as well, because I think one thing that Bon Jovi are missing is a heavier sound. I think they've what a lot of fans are saying is that the music is kind of rolling into one now. It's getting very the last album sounds like the one before and so on, and I think it'd be good now that they're all in the studio together for the first time in a while. Hopefully we get that sort of rock album that all us Bon Jovi fans want.
Yeah, it's a tricky thing. You make changes with producers, songwriters. If it's working, you don't want to mess it up. But on the other hand, you know, you want to try to stretch out and come up with, and you want to keep coming up with new ideas and new sounds. So yeah, it'd be interesting to see what they do. I'm sure they're thinking about that. I always used to do that with Mellencamp. 10 records, you're always trying to figure out what can we do that we haven't done, but still sound like ourselves.
With seeing Phil X and John Shanks and Tico at the Jimi Hendrix Experience, did you get to chat to them for a while at all? That's cool.
Oh yeah, there was a lot of people backstage. It was a Nashville. We had, you know, Brad from Aerosmith. We had all kinds of musicians there come see this Hendrix show, because it's really, really a big show.
Yeah.
You know, it's really cool. You got so many artists playing, you know.
Have you listened to any of Phil X's music before? Obviously, he's got a band called The Drills.
Oh, yeah. No, yeah. Oh, yeah. I played live with him.
Really?
I recorded with him.
Oh, wow. Yeah. What was that like?
Great.
Yeah. He's a fantastic guitarist, I must say, Phil X. Obviously, with Richie leaving, I was always a little bit scared of what it would be like having somebody else on stage. But he does a fantastic job, really, really fantastic job.
Oh yeah, he's one of the best guitar players out there.
What I was going to ask you was, obviously, we said that John done two solo albums, and in about 1999, 2000, just before the Crush album came out, there was rumours that he was doing a third album called Sex Cells. Was you asked to be involved in that album at all?
No, I didn't know anything about it.
Ah, okay, yeah. It ended up getting changed. It ended up being like a band album in the end. But it was originally meant to be a John Bon. This is the rumour anyway. I don't know how much of it's true, but apparently John was writing for the third album and then he ended up making it into a band album.
Yeah, I didn't know about that, you know.
I don't know how much of it he actually recorded, like, as a solo artist, to be honest with you. I don't know whether he maybe demoed some stuff on his own and then just decided to make it into a band album. But that's certainly like what we, us fans, have heard. I was wondering whether you'd maybe have been asked to be on that album as well.
Yeah. No, I wasn't involved. This is the first time I've heard about it.
When was the last time you done, like, kind of made, was it Destination Anywhere, the last time you made any type of music with John? Wow, was it, yeah?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So how long's that album now? 22 years ago?
Yeah, exactly.
Time flies, doesn't it?
Yeah, it sure does.
22 years. I was only 3 years old, 4 years old when that album came out.
so was I.
So as we discussed with Richie doing, you know, Undiscovered Soul, and you played on his album. Obviously, Richie has done Aftermath of the Lowdown in 2012. Did you get asked to be on that album at all?
Which one was?
Richie's third solo album.
The only one I got asked to do, the one I did, and that was because Don Warren was the producer. The next one, right, the recent one, is that the one you're talking about?
Yeah.
It came out a couple of years ago?
Aftermath of the Lowdown, yeah.
Nope, I didn't get asked to do that. He probably just wanted to do a different thing.
Yeah. I think he actually had like a kind of a full band for that album, if I'm not mistaken, as well. Yeah, I think it may have been his touring band.
So I know all those guys.
If John was, I mean, you said there that you kind of never say no, but there's always been rumors that John's gonna do another solo album. So in 2012, before the What About Now album, there was talks of John doing it, because he'd done a couple of solo songs, didn't he, for a film. I think it was called Stand Up Guys. I might be wrong. But again, if John would have asked you to be on that album, would you have happily have said yes for another solo album?
Oh, absolutely.
How often do you speak to John?
Maybe once a year.
Oh, okay.
I text him maybe a couple times a year.
Yeah. Was it planned for Phil X, John Shanks, and Tico to go to the Hendrix Experience? Did you know that they were going to be there?
No.
Ah. Wonder if the band plan on going there, like going to see them another time, because obviously, as I said, that the full band are in the studio at the moment.
Yeah, I know. I knew they were there.
Yeah.
I was gonna call them up, but we roll in, we roll out that night after the show.
Yeah. So how many shows this year are you doing with the Hendrix Experience?
I don't know how many, maybe 30 shows. It's like every day, almost every day is a show.
Wow.
I go till April 6th. Every day is a different city. It's a day off today.
Yeah.
But maybe do 5 shows in a row, maybe have a day off. 5 shows in a row, do a day off. Just keep going.
Is it going to come over to the UK?
No, I wish it was.
Is it not? No.
No, it's not right now, but... It's a very complicated tour because you have so many different artists with so many different managers with so many different this and so many different that.
Yeah.
It's easier to deal with one band. It's very complicated to do it with that many people. So and not knowing, I think it would sell incredibly well in England, France, Germany. Oh my God, you know. It would do very well. I mean, amazing. Well, you know, I'm gonna have to get off because I got to get to another interview. So I really appreciate you, you know, calling me and having me part of this.
No,
this was good for you.
Yeah, honestly, like thanks very much for your time.
Absolutely.
It's been, as I said, a pleasure to speak to you, and I, you know, there's so much that I wanted to chat about, because obviously, as I said, we've got a couple of fan questions, and that, have you got any time to answer a couple of fan questions before you leave?
Yeah, Sure. Okay. Sure. Yeah.
Tell me
those.
Okay. I've got a couple. So one of them was what's your best memory of the Blazer Glory sessions?
What's the best one?
Your best memory from the Blazer Glory sessions.
Recording Blazer Glory.
Yeah.
That was my best memory, and having some good talks with John after the session.
Can you obviously, can is there a certain part, as I said, when I listen to Santa Fe, that kind of just blows me away, listening to John's vocals. Was there a time when you were recording that album that it just made you go, wow?
No, Blaze of Glory was the one that did it the most.
Really, yeah?
Yeah. I mean, they all did, but I mean, I was just so happy to be there. But that one is the one, it was so long ago, that's the one that sticks out the most.
What was, obviously, as I said, I wasn't born at that time, but how big of a hit was that actually? Because to this day, when I mention Bon Jovi, a lot of people who aren't really fans of the band kind of say, oh yeah, Blaze of Glory. So just how big was that song when it got released?
I thought it went to number one on the top 100 singles, but it didn't. But it was number one on some other charts.
Yeah.
But it did really well. It was way up there in the top 10. I think it was at least in the top 10.
It was definitely, it's definitely like, I think over here it done, over in the UK, it done really, really well.
Yeah.
As I said, that's kind of like one of them songs that you mentioned Bon Jovi, and that's an answer that people always give you. They always say, oh, Blaze of Glory.
Are you saying people don't know it, or they do know?
No, that they do. Yeah, it seems to be the song that a lot of people take to.
Another question that somebody asked.
Yeah,
somebody else had.
Yeah, just talking on Santa Fe. Somebody said that John was John very enthusiastic about the song because live it doesn't really get played. So was it a song that he took to straight away?
I don't know. It obviously made the album, so
yeah,
you would never put it down if you didn't like it.
So, yeah.
Yeah.
Somebody else said, can you remember any songs that didn't make the Blaze of Glory album, and can you remember why they wouldn't make it?
No, too long ago.
Can you remember how many songs got recorded for that album?
Can't remember. But I have a file of all my charts from that sessions at home.
Oh, wow.
In LA. But I would have to go in that file, and that was like 1990.
Yeah.
Was it 1990?
1990.
Or
yeah.
Yeah. I have all the charts written out, but I can't remember. You know, I've made so many records since.
Yeah. And then somebody said,
if a fan's interested, I mean, John he was interviewed in my autobiography, Sex, Drums, Rock and Roll.
Ah, okay.
You can get that book on Amazon.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, Sex, Drums, Rock and Roll, The Hardest Hitting Man in Showbiz. And Jon Bon Jovi, there's a picture of John. A picture of John, me, and Elton John. We all look young. Holy shit, I even had hair on my head. Yeah, it's Elton John, me and John. We all look like young little kids.
As I said, it's crazy how quick time goes. I said,
yeah.
That, 1990.
You're only, how old are you now?
I'm 25.
Yeah, you're 25 and you're saying that. Well, you know what? One quarter of your life could be over, or one fourth of your life could be already over.
Yeah, it's frightening, really. And then somebody said, I think this is quite a good one, and you kind of touched on this at the start. If you could make a band out of all the musicians, not even so much who you've played with, but if you know, if you wanted to, could you make a full band, and who would be in it? So vocalist, guitarist, bassist, and on keyboards, and obviously yourself on drums.
Oh my god, where do you begin? I mean, like I said, Sting, Jeff Beck, have Elton John play piano, and Dave Grohl play the other guitar. Maybe Josh Homme in there somewhere. Oh my god, there's so many, you know. Have Lady Gaga as the backup singer.
Oh, really?
You know, she's one of the most talented people I've ever played with in my life. Ridiculous.
Really? Yeah.
Ridiculous.
Unbelievable. Was you working on her new album?
No. Played live with her in front of the president.
Wow, okay.
Yeah, we were honoring Sting. We played the Sting song. And she sat there and played on piano. She kept working it and practicing. And she kept developing. She could read music. She could make... It's just ridiculous how good she was.
Yeah, that's incredible, that.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Well, listen, I really, really thank you for your time.
Well, you're welcome, man.
It's been...
I'm sorry I have to get off. I have another interview. It starts in like 3 minutes.
Yeah, honestly, it's been an absolute pleasure to have you on, though.
Okay, man. Well, take care. Thank you for having part of your podcast.
No, and you. Thanks very much for your time. And hopefully speak to you soon sometime.
All right. Well, you take care.
And you. Thanks very much. Thank you.
Okay. Bye.
Bye.